Back to the channel. Today I'm going to talk to you about ElementaryOS. If you are a MacOS user and you're looking to switch over to a different operating system, maybe Linux is something that is catching your fancy and you want to give it a try, maybe switch over and just go all in and adopt it, we're going to take a look at a specific distribution called ElementaryOS. This is probably about the closest that you can get to having a macOS experience out of the box with Linux. ElementaryOS comes with its own desktop environment, which is unique from others, like basically a lot of the other distros out there use something like GNOME or KDE, whereas with macOS you get something called Pantheon. So what I'm going to do is take you through the process of getting this set up. We're going to go over some of the features of this that make it have that feel of macOS and the stuff that makes it unique from the other distros. If you want to skip through the setup, you can just go ahead and click down on the timestamps. I'll have timestamps to go through the install and then timestamps going through actually using the operating system. All right, so when you boot into ElementaryOS from your USB drive, you can click on the try or install ElementaryOS to get started here. All right, we are off and running on the install, so just go ahead and set up your language here. Go ahead and select, and then it's going to ask you for keyboard layout. This is all pretty much standard stuff. If you've installed operating systems before, if you haven't, this does a pretty good job of walking you through stuff. One of the things you can do is try demo mode. This is kind of almost like a live experience sort of thing. I'm just going to go ahead and erase disk and install here. And because I'm installing on a virtual machine, it's saying that some of these parts may not function properly because of that. Normally I would install on bare metal, but just for the sake of being able to get through videos, and also I don't have a remote capture card, so if I tried installing this right now, I just have to use like a cell phone or something to record the screen and the footage would end up looking like garbage. So we'll go ahead and click erase data. Now, something that's important here, because this is something that's standard with Linux, it's separate from like Windows where you can turn on BitLocker after the fact. When you install Linux, you know, this is putting aside things like using Veracrypt. If you're going to use the standard Linux method of encryption, which is the Linux Unified Key System, or LUX for short, it's going to ask you if you want to enable encryption. Now, if you skip this, LUX cannot be turned on later. Like I said, if you want to use something like Veracrypt, that's fine, you can do that. But if you want to use LUX, you have to set this up from the get-go, otherwise you cannot turn it on later after the system is installed. Now I'm going to go ahead and do this anyway. I'm just going to set up a crappy password here. Now, something to keep in mind here, because I cover a lot of cybersecurity stuff on this channel, is it's saying, hey, this password will fail a dictionary check. It's too simplistic or systematic. That's a good thing. It's letting you know that your password is too simple. Now, you don't want to forget the password, because you're going to lose all your data if you do, so make sure that whatever you set it to, that you'll remember it. But you want to use something that's, it's better than just like some normal run-of-the-mill garbage. Like I said, I'm just going to keep it simple because of the purpose of the video. So I'm going to go ahead and set encryption, and at this point you'll see that it's going to start doing what it needs to do. It doesn't take too long to install this, and once it's done, then we will go ahead and start taking a look around the operating system. All right, and we are now installed. It's saying that it's going to automatically restart. After restarting, you can set up a new user, so on and so forth. Let's just go ahead and click restart device. Now, when you set up a password and you're trying to boot in here, it's going to ask you for that password. That's why this screen is coming up here. So I'll just go ahead and put in the one that I created. All right, so now we're going to go through just a couple of screens here. We're gonna go ahead and select this stuff. I don't necessarily know why we need to set this stuff again when we set it in install. That's one of the things I don't really get about that part of it, but we'll go ahead and set up our username as well as a password. All right, and then from here, we'll go ahead and get logged in. All right, and here we go. So when you get booted in for the first time, you're gonna have this setup screen come up here. It's got things like the basics guide, community support, get involved. You can choose what you want for a look here. This is actually pretty slick. You can do like sunset to sunrise, so it'll be light themed during the day, dark during the night. I typically just prefer having dark theme all the time. You can also turn on night light, which is super nice if you want to reduce eye strain. Housekeeping is pretty slick with this operating system. So one of the things that you can do is automatically delete. So after 30 days, it will go and it does this to basically clean up junk on the operating system and also help with privacy. I'll show you some more of this here in just a second when we get opened up on a web browser. But basically, this will go and kind of decrapify your system automatically. If you want to use it, you can also set up your online accounts. I wouldn't particularly recommend this just from a security and perspective give because we'll get into that here in just a second. Next thing, we've got the App Center. You can also sideload Flatpak apps from FlatHub. We're gonna go over that here in just a second. That's actually a pretty slick feature as well. And you have automatic updates that can be installed automatically when you're connected to the internet. You can do free and paid apps. I'll go ahead and select that so I can show you that. And we can go ahead and get started. All right, so let's get into it. You might have noticed there's a little bit of glitchiness going on down here. Sometimes that's the joys of using Linux. Sometimes things don't work quite like they should. That's one of the big reasons that a lot of people, including myself, prefer to just stick to macOS and Windows because it's a little less of a headache sometimes getting things to work. So I'm gonna show you a couple of things here before we get into some of the more other stuff like system settings. I'm going to open up the App Center and I'm going to open up the web browser. Now, one of the reasons that I mentioned this, and I always talk about I frequently talk about cybersecurity stuff on my channel. And the reason I don't recommend that you just log into all that stuff right away on the quick setup is because these are generic applications. Now, I'm not saying anything bad about the app developers. I'm sure they do a great job and everything. I just don't like using generic stuff. So like this web browser here, for example, it's just a generic web browser that comes with the operating system. So what we're going to do is we're going to fix that and we're going to go to FlatHub. Now, one of the things that was mentioned earlier is that the App Center basically works in tandem with Flatpak. So once you install, they added this a couple versions ago back in version 5, that once you install an app from something like Flatpak or FlatHub, is that all of those applications are then available through the App Center. So what I'm going to do here is just go ahead and pick Firefox from the list to download, and I'm just gonna show this to you here real quick on the App Center. So if you come here to the App Center, and you type in, let's say, Brave for the Brave browser, you'll get no apps found, and we're about to fix that. So go ahead and let's go and download and install Firefox. One of the nifty things with this operating system that I do like, so we'll go ahead and do view downloads. We'll open this up. It's gonna say, do you want to install untrusted app? When you're downloading stuff from FlatHub, FlatHub is a legitimate repository. I don't think there's any reason to worry about downloading stuff from there. I will make a separate video talking about Flatpak, but one of the great things is basically everything is ran inside of like a sandbox. So one app cannot access the data from another app. That's the way that it is on macOS. It's really good for security. That's the way that I like things to be. So it's going to say, do you want to install this untrusted app? Here we go. So other apps from this distributor may appear in the App Center. So we're gonna go ahead and install this. That way we have something other than just a generic web browser. Shouldn't take too long for this to get done here. And so now we will go ahead and exit out of here, go to application. And now we have Firefox. So I'm just going to click and hold that so I can drag it down here and add it to the dock. By the way, when you want to take things off of the dock, all you have to do is drag and hold and basically just poof, get rid of stuff. No worries, you can customize all this stuff down here as you see fit. So it's going to say Firefox has been installed. Visit the App Center for app information. We'll get into all that here in just a second, including setting permissions. Now, if you go back to App Center, let's go ahead and search for the Brave browser again. Boom, there it is. So you can install it now and it will install It's getting pulled from FlatHub. So this is super slick. Like I said, they added this just a couple of updates ago. One of the things that I talked about here is, like I said, I just don't recommend in using generic versions of stuff. I think you should stick with things like Firefox. If you use Thunderbird or Outlook, whatever the case, use that. Just from a security perspective, again, I don't recommend using generic stuff. So let's go ahead and go back to the App Center here for just a moment, because there's something else that I wanted to show you. So I picked that option earlier to like update free and paid apps. You might be wondering what that's about. There is paid apps that you can buy through the App Center. I don't think these are nearly as polished as something like if you were to use Microsoft Outlook or something like that. Obviously there's a way bigger team of developers behind that, but you could support these devs if you want to. Now it says $10. You don't actually have to pay that. This is a pay what you want model. So you could pay like $1 if there's an app that you see in here that you'd like, or you can pay the full 10, whatever. Then you also have all of your free apps that you can download. There's a whole category of stuff that is available to you. The other thing I wanted to showcase real quick, it's not exactly like macOS if you're coming off macOS, and like I said, you're looking around here. So in macOS, you've got your minimize, expand, and close buttons over here, whereas with here, your expand button is here, and your exit button is over here like it would be on Mac. I imagine there's probably some sort of patent that Elementary OS couldn't really copy that same design over to their operating system to keep from getting in trouble, or who knows, maybe they just did it for stylistic or artistic choice. All right, next thing we're gonna do, we're gonna take a quick look at system settings. There's just a couple of things in here that I wanna mention. Pretty simple for the most part. You don't really need to goof around with this stuff a whole lot. One thing that I find interesting is that Wacom tablets have native compatibility, which is interesting. If you haven't seen my previous video talking about the landlord and the spying on Wi-Fi, it's not a Wacom tablet. Wacom is a brand, but it's a drawing tablet. So I find that interesting that that's integrated in here. We're going to take a look at security and privacy real quick. This is something that is pretty nice to have in the Mac and iOS sphere of things, and it is also here. It's really simple to get to security and privacy. So you have all of these settings here that you can customize, like history. Elementary OS can store local usage data to provide extra functionality. You can turn all this stuff off if you want to, which again, for me, talking about things from a cybersecurity perspective, that's what I really recommend. You can go ahead and do housekeeping. This is where you can set things. So you can delete automatically downloaded files. You can pick whatever you want here for settings. You can also turn on or off location settings. One of the other things I want to show you real quick when you click on applications here is you can set up your defaults for all of your application. So if you download Thunderbird, you could use that for your email client. If you have Brave installed, you'd have an option to pick like web, Firefox, or Brave, whatever. You can launch apps on startup if you want to. Really simple. You don't really need to do this if you don't want to. There's really not a whole lot of reason that you would really ever need to do it, because everything likely that you're going to want to use is going to be down here on your dock that is very similar to, like I said, macOS. The other thing here that's really nice to have that is just a couple buttons away is all of your permissions. Again, similar to macOS or an iPhone, where you can go and set stuff on a per app basis. So you can, for Firefox, obviously you would need things like network access, but printing, let's say you wanted to just go ahead and revoke access. That's something you can do. So you have all these different options here. That's pretty also from up here. If you want to, you can come up here and add or get rid of things as you see fit. Some of this stuff you wouldn't be able to install, kind of like on an Apple, how there's some things that you can't get rid of. But this has all of your settings up here to be able to do what you want. New window, new private window. You've got camera, all that kind of stuff. Very simple, very clean operating system. Then you have all of your little dock bar up here that has things like sound settings. You've got your internet settings that you can click on. You have all of your updates that come up here. And then you have your, obviously, your user account settings, lock, log out, all of that kind of stuff. So with that being said, it's a pretty simple video, but the thing again that I like about this is it's very similar to macOS. It gives you that feel. If you like Macs, which I mean, I'm a big fan of them. I'm not afraid to admit it. I know some people are, especially in certain spaces of the internet, some people are really against using certain types of operating systems because, well, it's ran by a corporation, and well, sometimes people just like to have stuff that's simple, it runs, it works. Now, I still prefer just running Mac or Windows rather than trying to find a Linux substitute. Linux is great, but there are things about Linux that take more time to learn, they take more effort. As you could see from the start of that video, when I booted in here for the first time, I had that glitchiness where these apps weren't showing up properly. Sometimes that's just stuff that you get with Linux. So, I mean, if you're willing to learn Linux, it's an amazing operating system. There's some great distributions out there, but it's just stuff that you have to be aware of. But if you're willing to put the time in to learn it, there's other stuff out there. Like if you are a Windows user, for example, maybe you'd want to switch to Linux Mint. You can use the Cinnamon environment and basically get something that feels very much like Windows. And I'll probably cover that at some later date, but that one's covered quite a bit already, so maybe I won't. I kind of prefer to stick to cybersecurity stuff on this channel, at least for the time being. So with all that being said, hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know what you think down in the comment section. And with all that being said, I will see you on Monday.